joining us for worship this day. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So please stand and join me in a word of prayer. We make our beginning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father God, we praise you and thank you. Thank you for giving breath to our lungs, Lord God. Thank you for this day that you have made us, you have created us, you have redeemed us by the precious blood of your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus. You are worthy of our worship. You are worthy of our praise. Thank you, Jesus, for all you've done for us. Amen.
Our first reading today is taken from Genesis 19, starting in the first verse through 14. The two angels came to Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. When Lot saw them, he rose to meet them and bowed himself with his face to the earth and said, "My lords, please turn aside to your servant's house and spend the night and wash your feet. Then you may rise up early and go on your way." They said, "No, we will spend the night in the town square." But he pressed them strongly, so they turned aside to him and entered his house. And he made them a feast and baked unleavened bread, and they ate. But before they lay down, the men of the city, the men of Sodom, both young and old, all the people to the last man, surrounded the house. And they called to Lot, "Where are the men who came to you tonight? Bring them out to us that we may know them." Lot went out to the men at the entrance, shut the door after him, and said, "I beg you, my brothers, do not act so wickedly. Behold, I have two daughters who have not known any man. Let me bring them out to you and do to them as you please. Only do nothing to these men, for they have come under the shelter of my roof." But they said, "Stand back." And they said, "This fellow came to sojourn, and he has become the judge. Now we will deal worse with you than with them." Then they pressed hard against the man Lot and drew near to break the door down. But the men reached out their hands and brought Lot into the house with them and shut the door. And they struck with blindness the men who were at the entrance of the house, both small and great, so that they wore themselves out, groping for the door. Then the men sent to Lot, "Have you anyone else here, sons-in-law, sons, daughters, or anyone else you have in the city? Bring them out of the place. For we are about to destroy this place because of the outcry of its people has become great before the Lord, and the Lord has sent us to destroy it." So Lot went out and said to his sons-in-law who were to marry his daughters, "Up, get out of this place, for the Lord is about to destroy the city." But he seemed to his sons-in-law to be jesting. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 2, starting in the first verse. "Therefore, we must pay closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For since the message declared by angels proved to be reliable, and every transgression or disobedience received a just retribution, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? It was declared at first by the Lord, and it was attested to us by those who heard, while God also bore witness by signs and wonders and various miracles and by gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to his will. For it was not to angels that God subjected the world to come, of which we are speaking. It has been testified somewhere, 'What is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor, and put everything in subjection under his feet.' Now, in putting everything in subjection to him, he left nothing outside his control. At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him, but we see him who for a little while was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one source. That is why he is not ashamed to call him brothers, saying, I will tell of your name to my brothers in the midst of the congregation. I will sing your praise. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I and the children God has given me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the Gospel, the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter, verses 2 through 16. Mark chapter 10, verses 2 through 16. And Pharisees came up and in order to test Jesus, asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of divorce and to send her away." And Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote you this commandment. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate." And in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. And he said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." Verse 13, "And they were bringing children to him that he might touch them, and the disciples rebuked them. But when Jesus saw it, he was indignant and said to them, 'Let the children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it.' And he took them in his arms and blessed them, laying his hands on them." This is the gospel of our Lord, and praise to you, O Christ. Let us be in prayer for marriages in our communities, in our churches. Satan loves to get a foothold in people's marriages. And let us pray that we would uphold that marriage is exactly as Jesus said, between one man and one woman for life, not the twisted and perverted way in which we look at marriage today in our society. So let's pray. Gracious Father, thank you so much for your amazing grace in our lives. Thank you so much for the gift of your mercy and grace. Thank you so much for the gift of marriage between a man and a woman, Lord God. And I want to pray right now for each and every marriage in our congregation, in our community, in whoever else is listening and hearing. There may be some trials and tribulations they're going through in their marriage, and I pray that they would find strength to work through those things, Lord God, in and through you, that Satan would have no foothold in their marriage, Lord God, but you, dear Jesus, be at the center of their marriage. Help them to practice the glue that will hold their marriage together, to apologize, to forgive, and to repent and to turn to you. We need your grace and we need your mercy in our lives, Lord God. Help us to encourage our spouse, to uplift our spouse, and to be a blessing and in service to one another. Serve one another, submit to one another out of reverence for you, Jesus. Help us, Lord God. We can't do it in our own strength. Give us supernatural strength to forgive one another and the wrongs that we have done to each other. So we lift these things before you and entrusting everything to Jesus, our great Savior, our great Redeemer, who has joined us, has reconciled us with the Father and given us life and hope in and through him. So we pray these things in his name. And as he taught us to pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and
morning again. Our text for the message today is taken from Genesis chapter 19, verses 1 through 14, as we go into a very difficult section of Genesis. Genesis 19, verses 1 through 14. Gracious Father, open our hearts and our minds to you, the hard things in your word. Teach us from your word now and help us to learn from the lesson you're trying to teach us in and through the word that has been preserved and passed down to us for such a time as this. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'd have to say that this passage of Genesis is very unsettling. It's not a pleasant section of the Bible to cover. And I think for me, it's simultaneously heartbreaking and on another level, it just makes me plain angry at the behavior of people. We see the depths to which human beings can go in their depravity, and we see God's wrath. The wrath of God, when it comes, is awful, it's unstoppable, and it is absolute. Lest we look at this account and think to ourselves, they got what they deserved, and we don't examine ourselves, we are in danger of not learning from this example and our need to repent. So chapter 19, verse 1, the two angels came to Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. When Lot saw them, he rose and to meet them and bowed himself with his face to the earth and said, "My lords, please turn aside to your servant's house and spend the night and wash your feet. Then you may rise up early and go on your way." They said, "No, we will spend the night in the town square." But he pressed them strongly, so they turned aside to him and entered his house. And he made them a feast and baked unleavened bread, and they ate. So for the first time, we see the men that had been speaking to Abraham. And remember, two of the three had left to go down to Sodom. And then the Lord remained in the presence of Abraham. And Abraham had a conversation with the Lord in regards to the judgment that was to come to Sodom. But we see now for the first time that they're identified as angels. Literally messengers. When Lot sees these angels manifested as men, he gets up from where he's sitting in the town gate, and similar to his uncle Abraham, when Abraham had first seen the three men who were angels and the Lord approaching his camp, similar to that, Abraham offered them hospitality. Lot offers them hospitality. At this point, you could say Abraham and his nephew Lot were cut from the same thread. They're caring, hospitable people, willing to bring people into their homes, willing to feed them, to house them for a night, to give them shelter, to give them protection. Hospitality and caring for people is a mark of the Christian faith. And as I said a few weeks ago, that hospitality can start with each other in our own communities, in your own church where you're at, in our own congregation. Getting to know one another is important in order to be able to care for one another. Going out to lunch with someone that you see maybe week in and week out in your church, but you don't really know them all that well. Maybe go out to lunch with them. Maybe open your house to some people to have them over to dinner from time to time. So Lot has this mark of the Christian faith and the Christian life up to this point. But things quickly take an unimaginably ugly turn. Verse 4. But before they lay down, that is, before they retired for the night, the men of the city, the men of Sodom, both young and old, all the people to the last man surrounded the house. And they called to Lot, Where are the men who came to you tonight? Bring them out to us that we may know them. This is so ugly we can hardly speak of it. In Genesis chapter 4, verse 1, we read that Adam knew his wife Eve, and she gave birth. The Hebrew word translated as knew is yada. I mean that they had sexual relations. The same Hebrew word yada is found in Genesis chapter 19, verse 5, that we had just read. Bring them to us that we may know yada them. What the men were planning to do is gang rape these two men, who were actually angels that had come into their town. Strangers that had come. We may say to ourselves, how could a society possibly sink to such levels? Yet we have rich and powerful people such as Jeffrey Epstein and P. Diddy, who use their wealth and their power for purposes of sex trafficking. And let's be honest, there were plenty of people who participated then in those sex parties. Didn't ask any questions, just went along with everything. Closer to home, each year, each school year at Penn State, around 70 survivors of sexual assault seek medical care and DNA evidence collection vital to their health and pursuit of justice at Mount Nittany Medical Center. Now, during this process in which the person has been a survivor of sexual assault, these survivors face the decision to either give up their clothing as evidence that has the DNA material on it, right? And be left to return home in their medical examination gown, or to keep their clothing and thereby their dignity, but forsake a compelling legal case. Difficult position, right, to be put in after being sexually assaulted. So unlike the people of Sodom, we like to keep our ugliness a little more hidden, a little less direct. A date drug slipped into someone's drink at the bar, all hidden. Not a direct, come on out so we can rape you. I want to rape you. Even participating in so-called victimless crimes, such as viewing pornography, perpetuates an industry that preys on the vulnerable. Our churches, our culture and our church, you know, our whole society is flooded with these things. Maybe if we're honest with ourselves, the line dividing Sodom and modern day America is much closer than we would like to admit. And Christians, we have to ask ourselves, how much are we compromised by this sexual freedom, quote, freedom culture? How far are we willing to go in the name of sexual freedom? We even use euphemisms now. We call it reproductive freedom. Up to this point, it appears that that Lot and his household were protected. They were protected by the memory of what Abraham, his uncle, had done for Sodom in rescuing them after they were defeated by a coalition of kings and taken off into captivity. And Sodom and Abraham tracked them down, defeated them, and brought back those who had been enslaved and all the goods that had been taken from Sodom in their defeat. So Lot, in some sense, was protected, his household was in some sense protected because of the memory of what his uncle Abraham had done for them. So what did Lot do with that favored status he had in Sodom? Did he bear witness to the truth? Or had he become compromised in his thinking and actually joined the culture? Well, sadly, it is clear which path he took. Verse 6. So when these men want to have the men of the town want the men to come out and want to rape them, Lot went out to the men at the entrance, shut the door after him, and said, "I beg you, my brothers, do not act so wickedly. Behold, I have two daughters who have not known any man." Hadn't been had any sex with any man. They're virgins. "Let me bring them out to you and do to them as you please. Only do nothing to these men, for they have come under the shelter of my roof." I have to be honest with you. As the father of three daughters, it is hard for me to read this passage and not just be raging angry. I want to punch Lot in the face. You called those men wicked for what they wanted to do, and this is your solution? Here, take my daughters and do with them as you please. His thinking had become perverted and twisted. There are many Christians living in our society whose thinking has become perverted and twisted, justifying what God calls evil and wrong as acceptable and even good. Whole churches who teach people that it is fine, just fine, to follow your sexuality wherever that leads you, despite what the scripture says. Whole churches falsely teaching that your gender is whatever you want it to be. The church is complicit with our society in elevating the self as the highest thing. Let me say this, the idolatry of self in our society and in the church is killing the witness of the church in the world around us. Verse 9. "But they said, 'Stand back. We want to do what we want to do,' the mob. And they said, 'This fellow came to sojourn, and he has become the judge. Now we will deal worse with you than with them.' Then they pressed hard against the man Lot and drew near to break the door down. And the men reached out their hands and brought Lot into the house." That is, the angels, you know, reached out their hand, brought Lot into the house with them and shut the door. "And they struck with blindness the men who were at the entrance to the house, both small and great, so that they wore themselves out groping for the door." Lot's idiotic cultural compromise didn't placate the mob. If you think as a Christian you're compromising on the truth of God's word and being nice in regards to what the culture calls nice is going to fix what ails this culture, you're kidding yourself. There are many churches that shy away from speaking the truth about God and speaking about the wrath of God. We just need to be nice, as society defines nice. And then we will change society. The reality is that the culture has changed you. You haven't changed the culture. Despite Lot's own compromising wickedness, we see God's mercy towards him in preserving his life in spite of himself. I have to be honest with you, I can think back on my own life. Would there have been times when God spared me in spite of the wrong and sinful decisions I had made? In a moment, my life could have been completely shipwrecked, yet God spared me. The question for you and I, when God spares us, is do we learn from those events? Would Lot learn from this? Then the men said to Lot, "Have you anyone else here, sons-in-laws, sons, daughters, or anyone you have in the city? Bring them out of the place, for we are about to destroy this place because of the outcry against its people has become great before the Lord, and the Lord has sent us to destroy it." So Lot went out and said to his sons-in-laws who were to marry his daughters, "Up, get out of this place, for the Lord is about to destroy the city." But he seemed to his sons-in-laws to be jesting. God had tried all he could to reveal himself to Sodom. He spared them 15 years ago through Abraham. The lesson wasn't learned. Lot had become compromised, remaining there. I mean, look at it. Who were his daughters going to marry? Guys from the city. Guys from Sodom. Who might have been in the crowd seeking to have those men that were under Lot's house protection to come out and rape them. Nevertheless, you know, they were going to marry into that. That's how compromised Lot was. They continued the path of wickedness in their lives. The wrath of God was to come. I have to be honest, there's a part of me that would want to cheer God on in the destruction of that place. And yet, I have to realize that I deserve the same wrath. There's a song that was written by, I think it's Keith Getty, and "In Christ Alone." One of the verses is, "Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ, I live." Let's pray. Oh, Lord God, help us. Help us by your grace to live our lives as a reflection of all that you have done for us in and through your one and only Son, Jesus. That we wouldn't compromise the truth, but we would be the church and we would stand as a beacon of light in the darkness of the culture in which we live. That we wouldn't be We won't compromise and adhere to whatever the culture says is good, but we would look to you and to your word, to your wisdom, to your guidance in all things. Teach us your ways, O God. By your mighty hand, give us strength to stand up and to proclaim that you are the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through you. Amen. Let us confess together our faith in the triune God and all he has done for us. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We're having a time of confession before the Lord, and the Lord knows what's really on our heart, But what he's inviting us to do is come before him, be honest before him, come into his presence. Don't hide anything from him, run to him. It's a mistake for us to run from God. We should run towards him and confess to him. So let's open our hearts and our minds to him. There'll be a time of silence as well that we can really pour out our hearts to God. So from the words from 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 and 9, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's take a moment in silence to reflect upon our need for Christ. So Lord, let us confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. But for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Hear the good news. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the gift of the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you for worshiping with us this day. We need to be reminded of this at times in our life, and really each and every day in our life. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God. Have you given thanks to God this day? Have you given thanks? Have you maybe made a list of things that you can be thankful for in your life? And to think on those things. We can go so easily go down the negative path. Woe is me, everything going wrong, this and that and the other thing. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.